Stereo Mono Broadcast Park. Yo, what up? You're rocking out on the Angelo Show. Stereo Mono Broadcast Podcast on Blast. DJ Club Chief Max Carrison.
You need the ability to share that in an anonymized way across companies and between the public and private sector. We've got to solve that problem. It's not about blame. We're being attacked. And what we're doing is we're saying missiles are hitting us. Who should we blame? And the answer is all of us right now we can blame because we know we need a better defense. Let's get out and create that better defense. The way we've been doing it doesn't work. We need to take this next step and come up with a true behavioral set of capabilities that can share anomalies at network speed and help us to defend our nation and work with our allies.
So when you look at the increasingly aggressive attacks of nation states, of Russia, of China, would you say that we're on the verge of an all-out cyber war, or are we already in one?
I think I'd take a step back. I think Russia, my view, Russia was trying to figure out what we were doing on indicting the GRU folks that did the attack on Ukraine in 2017, and they were collecting a lot of information. But your point, I would now say, look at what they learned. They got into 18,000 companies. That's a huge problem. This is something that our country needs to step back and say, if that had been destructive against those 18,000 companies, we're in a totally different place. We need to step up. We need to figure out how we're going to solve this problem. And it can't be, please don't attack us, because when something bad happens, they will. So we now need to say, okay, how are we going to work with us, within our country, and with our allies to defend in this space? All our wealth, our future is in this network. We got to solve this.
I'm like, Yeah.
wrong.
Oh, Information
professional
would be unacceptable to Americans and to most citizens of the free world. And therefore, a digital dollar will be crucially dependent on having
an effective
authentication component. That is a secure and legally traceable and maximally privacy-preserving way for
our Illinois, Rep. Bill Foster.
Legally traceable individual. A secure digital ID, and it must be backed by a trusted court system and a clear legal regime to determine the conditions under which the participants might be unmasked. As a digital dollar, if it's to be used internationally, we're then going to need a digital ID system that operates internationally.
Okay.
At least among the free countries of the world.
Digital dollar.
I'd like to thank you both for beginning engagement with
Congress
and other countries on central bank digital.
You have no idea what we're talking about.
I'm wondering where you see this discussion going as far as a secure digital ID and a means of authentication across boundaries, across countries.
Innovating the digital dollar.
I should let Chair Powell start with this because he's been more involved than I have.
Thank you. So, where we are is we are engaged in a process of looking at
the road to hell.
That's one of the most basic ones. Reflecting your earlier question, I don't think that
a system financial service
entirely on,
Bloomberg US dollar,
completely private governance or completely secret information about who's actually owning the digital dollar would not be viable. And, the lack of privacy in the Chinese system is just not something we could do here at the same time. So there's got to be a balance, and it does call for using the two-tiered system in some way so that there's a lot of outside of the central bank, and transfers can take place there, and that there are appropriate protections. We're only beginning to think carefully about these things. And it's going to be a careful, detailed, and probably lengthy process of consideration. One that we're investing quite a bit in now, and I expect will last some time.
Yeah. Secretary Yellen, did you have any thoughts on this? The issue of a secret ID is very much in your court, having to do with one of the things the coronavirus laid bare is the lack of You know, simply unless you have the investments in the U.S. and then are willing to rapidly distribute funds, particularly for the underbanked. You know, a high quality and universal digital ID that immeasurably easier, as well as everything from, you know, vaccine certificates or you name it. And so this has been, you know, it's an ongoing discussion on many fronts. And there are also specific proposals. I believe you have letters urging both of you to look into this in more detail. And so I was just wondering what the state, just as simply as a means for citizens to receive payments, you know, Fed accounts, you know, each one of us has already the federal government.
I have to
The IRS. And I'm kind of wondering how you saw this part of the conversation going.
I think it's something that's worth exploring. I've not done so, but we would be glad to have further conversations with you about how something like this could work.
Which is the
problem that you've mentioned.
This time, the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Williams, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and thank you, Madam Secretary.
Tax is running hard.
Administration tax plans are becoming clearer each day. But from what we've learned so far, the president was not really telling the truth when he told voters that anyone earning less than $400,000 did not have a pay raise in taxes. And this number's been reduced to anyone making $200,000 a year.
Fucking Texas. Don't mess with Texas. That's Robert Williams, Republican. Fucking Republican.
Hey, Texas.
Well, you got a eyebrows like me.
This will stifle business investments, preventing foreigners from hiring more people, and reduce capital struggling businesses that will need to make the necessary changes to accommodate the new normal after COVID-19. So, Chairman Powell, can you talk about the correlation between business investment and productivity gains, and how increasing productivity benefits workers and the overall economy?
Sure. I mean, really the way living standards rise over time is through increasing productivity, more output per hour. Without that, incomes can't sustainably rise, and that is significantly connected to investment in human capital, and also in advancing technology.
Okay, thank you. At the beginning of 2020, Congress updated the Bank Secrecy Act and made some of the largest changes to our anti-money laundering laws in decades. When this legislation was signed to law, there were some concerns coming from the business community about the impact this will have on small businesses in the form of additional regulatory costs. As a small business person, I can tell you that's a burden that we do not look forward to. And as you start putting out guidance and implementing the law, I hope you will be mindful of this and do all you can to ensure businesses will not be stuck with significant new expense. So, Secretary Yellen, can you give us a status update on Treasury and Fenton's work in implementing the Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2020?
Timely and effective implementation of the Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2020 is the top priority at FinCEN. Our efforts are well underway, and several of the provisions of the Act that involve FinCEN looking at innovation, regulatory reform, and the like, we're actively engaged in. So this is something that's a high priority, and we're making progress on it.
Okay, thank you. Chairman Powell, in the past, we have talked about the workforce participation rate and how we need to get people off the sidelines and contributing to our economy. In other words, just put them to work. In your testimony, you felt that this figure is still notably lower than it was before the pandemic, and yet the COVID-19 bill recently extended the enhanced unemployment benefits until September. Now, I consistently express my concerns about how this policy will be detrimental to our economic recovery and make it more lucrative to frankly live off these overly generous government programs than go out and find a job. So, Chairman Powell, given the enhanced unemployment benefits are now law, how should we be incentivizing people to get off the sidelines and back in the workforce and make a good living for their families?
I think the most important thing is for people to get vaccinated so that we can get the economy fully reopened so that those jobs can come back and people can feel safe doing them.
Do you have an answer to that, Ms. Young?
I agree with that. So I think many people who are not working are not doing so because of safety concerns. considerations only because they have children out of school. And the studies that have been done about whether or not the additional payments discourage work show pretty clearly that they don't serve to do that. In addition, they will be expiring in the fall.
So in my remaining time, I just want to talk about increasing taxes earlier. I would just say as a small business owner employs hundreds of people in Texas, it's pretty simple. If you cut taxes, you increase jobs. If you raise taxes, you cost jobs. Any way you look at it. So I hope that everybody will understand that raising taxes to any business is not good for our economy. I yield back my time, Madam Chairman.
Thank you very much. I now call on Mr. Wallace from California for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I appreciate very much this hearing. I also congratulate in the strongest way Secretary Young. It's quite an honor to have a woman now running Treasury. It's very, very exciting. Deficit spending when we Democrats are in power. They don't seem to remember that when they are, especially the $1.9 trillion giveaway to the wealthiest American tax giveaway. They probably even more now because the wealthiest have made so much money during this pandemic. But one of the things that I found so interesting about this particular hearing is that we have two incredibly intelligent people presenting today, and one's a Democrat and one's a Republican. One appointed by a Democrat and one appointed by a Republican. And yet, they seem to be principled, scientific, speaking about the facts and not crazy things. And this is the way it used to be. And so I appreciate it very, very much. And again, can't tell you how much I have enjoyed listening to this intelligent conversation. I'm sure that the Secretary and the Chairman have differences of opinions, as they should. But it would be done on a factual basis. And it would be done, I think, intelligently and scientifically.
John Vargas from Public California.
I do want to ask about climate change. It seems that both of you have the notion that climate change could be a big deal, and is in your study. What are the long-term investments that we need to be looking at with respect to climate change in our economy?
Four logo?
And either one can go first.
Well, I'd start off by saying that climate change poses very severe risks to the well-being of humanity, and it's a global problem that demands a global solution. So while we need to address climate change at home, we also need to work globally to help other countries, particularly poorer countries, have the resources to address it as well. It is a top priority of the Biden administration. President Biden has released a detailed plan to combat climate change. We've rejoined the Paris Agreement. We intend to put forward a proposal to invest in sustainable infrastructure and to create new green jobs in the process. We've talked earlier in this hearing about evaluating the risks to businesses and to financial institutions from climate change, which the financial regulators are doing, and I hope to facilitate through EFSA and sharing of information on best practices. We need to focus on information and disclosure of information about the risks to companies that investors need to channel their capital to the right directions.
Mr. Chairman, so what about the risks to businesses and financial institutions? Mr. Chairman, so we see this through a different lens, appropriately, from the Treasury Department, and that really is a lens for existing mandate to supervise banks
and some other institutions to assure that they're understand and are managing the risks that they're running in their business. And we don't have a new mandate that that's what we do. And climate change is an emerging risk. So we're looking at it carefully. We actually are just in the very early stages of considering stress scenarios, and that's what others are doing too. It's an emerging idea. It's not actually something that people...